So here's the real question. How do dentists like you, who aren't willing to let insurance dictate how you will run your practice, who want to create incredibly profitable practices without sacrificing your time or sanity, how do you create the strategies to ensure your practice not only survives, but thrives in the 21st century? That's the blaring question. And Dr. Steve Schlintz is here to provide the answers. Welcome to Dental Practice Freedom Radio.
What is up, everybody? This is Dr. Steve Schlintz. I want to welcome you back to another episode of Dental Practice Freedom Radio. And as you know, if you've been listening to this, we are going over my switch from disease care to health care or wellness care, whatever you want to call it, and talking about some of the key points and key things that I did as I made this switch from a commodity-based patch, fill, drill, bill, whatever you want to call it, disease care model, to a holistically inclined wellness-based model. One of my colleagues and mentors, kind of when I got started on this journey, was Mike Robichaux, and Dr. Mike Robichaux, and he talked about his practice being holistically inclined, and I loved that concept because we get this connotation of holistic or biologic dentist, and we're thinking immediately this is a misconception. That if you say I'm a biologic dentist, what that means is I wear a tin hat and I take out all amalgam all the time. And I didn't like that, but it's like, well, what if you're not a biologic dentist, what are you, right? If you don't understand biology and how to approach the system in a biologic fashion, what are you doing? Are you a carpenter? Or are you a mechanic? It just didn't make any sense to me. So this connotation that in order to be a holistic dentist, you have to take out, you know, mercury fillings and you have to, you know, scare the public in whatever orientation you're in. It doesn't matter to me, but that's not what a holistic dentist actually means. A holistic dentist is, in my opinion, one who treats the system, looks at causes of disease, not simply symptoms. And I've met a lot of quote unquote holistic dentists that are actually still disease care specialists. They don't look at the system at all. So, you know, I do want to make that distinction as we go along. And as I continue to go along in these episodes, I think more and more of that is going to come out just because I do feel so strongly about not only what holistic dentistry and having a wellness care practice can do for the dentist, it's also what it can do for the patients. So I will continue to get onto that path as I go. But, you know, for the foreseeable future, all I want to do is talk about the things that I did in my practice to start to make the shift from disease care to health care. So the first was, if you remember, identifying the vision of the practice that you want. The second thing you have to do now is identify the ideal patient. And I will tell you, this is where 99% of dentists struggle. They don't know. And you ask and they're like, well, my ideal patient pays their bills. They show up on time. That's not your ideal patient. That's just a patient that does what they're supposed to do, right? I'm talking about a customer avatar, your ideal patient, your ideal client. If you were to pick exactly what kind of patient you want, what would that patient look like for you? I'll give you a great example. Because I do a lot of TMD and full mouth rehabilitations in my practice, and that's pretty much what I do now, my patient avatar is early 50s female. Basically, kids are pretty much through school, and now they're getting in a position where they want to invest back in their health, and they probably have headaches, they have tooth wear, or they have joint symptoms, they're in trouble, and they need some help. And they might not even know what caused their headaches, but they have headaches, and they have neck pain, they have shoulder pain, they're tense all the time, and they want a solution. That's my ideal patient. I mean, I could go further and further and further, but if you've noticed, I put sex of the patient, age of the patient, what that patient's looking for. You could get into what does that patient buy? What is the income of the patient? What do they eat? All of those things go into this quote unquote ideal patient avatar. Now, what I see, and this happens a lot in practices, is they A, don't know what that is, and B, even if they knew, they would send out a marketing message that's completely inconsistent with that. And so they'll say, well, I want a mid-50s female. They have money. They know what to do with it, blah, blah, blah. They're not too old to where they think I'm too old for dentistry. But yet their whole marketing approach is geared more towards young families or kids or whatever the case may be. Listen, this is so important that in order for you to start to move towards whatever kind of practice you want, you have to know who your ideal patient is. And so you might be asking me, why that patient? Because to me, that patient, that mid-50s female that's been through the loop, they've been through the dental cycle, they have enough of a dental story for them to know that something needs to change in order for them to go where they need to go, is more likely and more open to a partnership-based approach than maybe late 20s male who is completely insurance dependent and doesn't really care. He wants to get in and out in 5 minutes, right? Why would I market to that person? They don't want what it is that I offer. So I know that in a relationship-based, holistically-based practice, there has to be two to tango. My patient has to want what it is I'm offering as well. And so I play the odds. I know that the majority of my patients end up being that customer avatar, that patient avatar, and they want what it is that I'm offering in my practice. I can't stress that enough. And this is something you should be focusing on as a dentist. Don't focus on Twitter. Don't focus on Instagram. Don't focus on Facebook. Don't focus on any of that stuff yet, because those are all marketing tools. Well, you can't use a tool if you don't understand what you're using the tool for. And so Facebook, for example, incredibly powerful tool to be able to basically get into socioeconomic status of the person you're targeting through Facebook, where they live, what zip code, what are their interests, all of these things. But that's not going to help you if you don't actually know who it is you're trying to attract into your practice. How are you going to create a marketing video if you don't know who it is you're trying to attract? And so if you say, well, I'm trying to be all things, I'm a family dentist, and I'm just a general dentist, and I just want to see everyone. That marketing approach works for no dentist ever. Not going to work. It's never going to happen because everybody else is doing the same thing. So you need to have a marketing approach that's geared towards that specific ideal patient avatar. Now, if I created a marketing campaign, just think about how much more effective this would be. If I knew that my ideal patient was mid-50s female who had headaches, maybe they'd seen the chiropractor before, they have money to invest in their health, and I start to gear a campaign or marketing approach specifically speaking to that person, how much more effective do you think that'll be? I'll take that every time. I can speak directly to that patient. And I know that some of the stuff I do, even if it's on the podcast or if I'm using the program, my program Dental Sales Secrets, and I have a dentist call me and say, that I feel like you're speaking directly to me. What I want to tell them is, I know that's why I wrote it that way. I want to be speaking directly to you. So you're my person. You're who I want in my tribe. You're who I want in my circle because I'm gearing my message specifically towards you. There might be people that come in that aren't into that avatar, right? You might still get the mid-20s dude that comes into your practice like, hey, I heard about this practice. I heard it's pretty cool, so I wanted to give it a shot. That's going to happen as a trickle effect, but that isn't going to be your main marketing approach. So really, 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 really important that you identify your ideal client, your ideal patient. And then from there, you can create a marketing approach that's consistent towards that ideal patient. So hopefully you got some value out of that. The next episode, I'm going to talk more about defining your blue ocean in your practice, what it is you're trying to do. As always, please leave reviews or ratings if you find value out of this. You can go to dentalpracticefreedomradio.com, and you can get a free case acceptance master pack. It's 5 videos to help you increase your case acceptance. Just as my thank you to you for listening to this. And hopefully you have a great day, and I'll see you at the next episode.
Thank you so much for listening to this episode on Dental Practice Freedom Radio with Dr. Steve Schilintz. We'll see you on the next episode.